Now, before we jump into the dollar and inflation, we just wanted to remind you, please like, share, subscribe. We appreciate the support. You know, it helps helps us in a lot of ways. So thanks again for, and then again, this also segment was sparked by a request from a commentator. So we're hopefully this answers some of the questions. And if you have more, again, please reach out. And then I know someone else had a question about, you know, putting together a frac spread and why it's actually a good thing. And that's something that we're going to cover again next week. You know, I just have to find time to put those shows together, unfortunately. But so this is something that I thought was a great chart that really kind of highlighted, you know, what is happening in the world today. So we've talked about US dollar denominated debt, and we go through it in more detail in a different way. And this is looking at it as a percentage of GDP. So there's about 10% of GDP that is tied up in US dollar denominated debt, which is why the US dollar strength and weakness is so important. Now, foreign ownership of emerging market economies, local currencies, sovereign bond debt, sovereign bond markets, again, is about 20%. So we're seeing, you know, this has started to increase. This has started to see some movements overall. But the issue is getting dollars into your system. And what does that mean? That means that if I have FX reserves, so I have my reserves, say I have 70% in dollars, you know, 15% in euro, and the mixture of other currencies and gold, I'm going to front run or front load the US dollar invoicing because I'm going to invoice in dollars. So emerging market and economies, you know, 82% is going to be exports are in dollars, and imports are about 80% in dollars. I'm gonna always have my FX reserves to fulfill those crossings. Now, when I invoice, the question is, when do I get paid? So when we look at a slowdown in debt, a slowdown in trade, so as trade slows, then there's going to be a less dollars coming in. And as less dollars come in, that means that, okay, well, I'm going to have to put out more from my FX reserves. And now with advanced economies slowing, as we showed in segment one with the deviation between daily activity, high frequency data points, as advanced economies slow, well, their speed of paying invoices is also going to slow. And as invoices slow, then that means that the dollars that the emerging market economies were expecting also start to slow. And this is that reverberating impact that we continue to talk about. And we go through it in the US dollar dynamics show because it's a very important kind of thing to try to understand, because this is going to create an overarching problem and an issue to be considered as we continue down a path of recovery, as it starts to get lumpy, as we start to see COVID create issues, because imports in some of these advanced economies have slowed. So that means that exports have slowed, which means, again, less dollars coming through. And then even the dollars that do come through are being brought back on shore in terms of invoices at a slower rate. And then the dollar denominated debt that has to be financed comes from FX reserves. And you can see how this can get ugly very quickly as the flow and movement of dollars continue to find struggle and strife, which is why there is still a net shortage of dollars in the world, which is why, even though the dollar has a lot of haters and it was a great short from 95 down, it always finds the support, especially as we start to go into the new year. Now, when we look at yield curve deviations, I think this was a great chart that really kind of highlights where the S&P 500 is and where rates and what that 10-year versus 2-year is really, and that yield curve is starting to do as it continues to shift higher. Now, clearly, it's moved up before and the market didn't even blink, but we're in a different place with a different amount of debt. And now the question is, does the Fed buying this amount of debt provide some semblance of stability, which is why we've continued to see a grind higher as we've seen the yield curve, you know, shift higher, and as we've seen some of this uncertainty. But it's an important juncture right now as we start to see rates creeping higher, as we start to see inflation fear starting to pick up, which is going to, again, as in, as inflation expectations move higher, that means that the 10-year yield is going to be pulled up as well. The 30-year is already starting to show that, and now the Fed's talking about buying longer-dated bonds in order to try to mitigate some of that risk. But again, these are issues that we're looking at as the S&P 500 reaches these all-time highs, as the underlying pieces of the economy just don't really follow suit in the same way, which is, again, coming full circle to where we're looking at debt securities. So when we look at debt securities over here, so this goes only to June, just because it hasn't updated, and you can see that gold share, you know, this is GLD, you can see GLD is, you know, to the moon. But this is the DXY. So the DXY has had a nice move lower, similar to what we saw in 2017, as you see things normalize. But up here, and this is, again, a bigger problem, we've seen debt and loans increase. Debt and loans have increased in order to finance said, you know, stimulus, which has pushed the market higher. So far, the market has not cared on this just massive propensity to borrow. And now this is debt at the emerging market level, which continues to push higher. Now, the dollar coming down provides a certain amount of reprieve. But again, we think that the dollar has found some stability, and going into the ECB is going to be a bigger concern as we start to see things, you know, start to accelerate, which is, again, why gold has continued to outperform. Now, when we look looking at the US specifically, because all of the dollar is going to have a very large impact on the emerging markets, and which isn't lost on the Fed, which you could say, why is the Fed doing so much? Well, it's in order to do some of the activities to make the dollars available. But let's look at federal debt, public debt. And you could see, obviously, the acceleration as we got into 2020. We went from 24 trillion to 28 trillion almost over, I should say 23 to 27 almost instantly. But the M1 money stock, this is the fun one. This went from 4 trillion to about 6.3 trillion in a straight line. Now, this is a lot of liquidity to hit the market, but where is it? Because the velocity of money hasn't really done the same, and it's important to appreciate what is the velocity of money? What is that calculation? What does it mean overall? Which we're going to talk about in a second, but let's look at this a little bit differently, because these are all very big numbers, but what does it mean on a percentage level? So year over year percentage increase in 2020, it went from about 10% to almost, let's call it about, you know, 57, 55%. So we have increased the money supply by almost 40% in just 2020. Now, this is a significant amount of dollars that have to be absorbed, but where do they live? Because clearly we're not seeing them the same way, but you have to think about, how is the velocity of money calculated? So when we look at the federal debt total, so U.S. debt hits $27 trillion in Q3. The U.S. has added $17 trillion in debt, or 63% of its entire debt in just 12 years since 2008. So since 2008, and when you can see we have gone epically parabolic, and then we just set a new record here. Now, the Fed is buying it, as we talked about in the first segment, they're buying $120 billion at a clip. So it's being internalized, but when they buy the debt, they issue the dollars. And then the question is, where are the dollars going, and how can we find where those dollars are actually, you know, going through the system? And that's when we come to the velocity of money. So you can see that there has been a slight uptick in MZM, which is looking at M1, M2, M3. It's looking at things all together. And this is, you know, when we look at M1, the velocity of money didn't do all that much. It increased a little bit, but not. M2 was where we saw the biggest increase in the velocity. But what is the velocity of money? When we look at it, it's price. So it's P times essentially one GDP unit divided by the money supply. So when we look at the velocity of money, you know, as we've talked about, let's go to 2008, you know, the velocity of money has been going down. Let's go to 2008, where we had a marked drop and then an acceleration to the downside. Why is that? And this comes back down to prices have started to go up. You know, we've seen prices start to go up this year, but GDP has been weak and GDP has been relatively soft. So GDP growth has been minimal, but the denominator keeps getting bigger. So when you look at the velocity of money, as you grow the denominator with a numerator that continues to either shrink, find pressure, you're inherently going to see a decline in the velocity of money because the prices are going up, GDP is remaining weak, and the denominator is getting massive. And we show just the level of how massive that denominator is getting. Well, how do you fix it? You either increase prices, which we've seen in different areas of the economy. For people who buy stuff, prices have gone up. For people that aren't buying their stuff, whether that be airfare, tickets to football games, concerts, whatever, all of those prices are down. But the stuff that you're actually buying is going up. But when you blend them together, it looks like prices are down. So then at the same time, GDP has been fairly weak for the last several, essentially decade. Now, we have had growth. I'm not saying that we haven't had growth. Obviously, 2018 was strong. 2014 was something strong, was fairly strong. Like there's been recovery. It's just we're in a point now where we're starting to get a little bit of a velocity pickup because prices are finally starting to run, but the denominator keeps getting bigger. And once it's a matter of shrink the denominator or increase the numerator. And at this point, the denominator, it would have a huge impact. But again, we wouldn't be able to tolerate that, which is why velocity of money is going to remain very depressed. And it's going to have a lot of pressure to come back to the upside. Now, with all that being said, there is nothing but euphoria in the market right now. And everybody is just can't get enough stocks. I love getting typical bubble commentary of buy everything, stocks never go down. This is, the Fed has figured it out. They've broken the market. There's no price realization. Things are only going higher. Again, these are things that we hear at the top of every bubble. The problem is, how do you time that? And your guess is as good as mine. Some things that I look at that I'm like, oh, this is a really bad data point. This will matter. No, it doesn't. It doesn't. So again, it's just going to be a matter of when do we get some normalcy and some price discovery in the market. And here you can see that there is just a rampant move to buy as much as possible. And it's happening with people levering up, buying weekly, monthly options, and trying to kind of capture a lot of these increases. Now, what is another way to capture these market moves? Well, let's create exchange-traded funds. Let's create ETFs. Let us get as passive as possible. And as the passive amounts come in, as people start buying ETFs, those ETFs then have to go out and purchase the underlying stocks. So if you have, say, a Tesla or an Apple that has to be in every single ETF and you have an increase in ETFs, well, that is a natural buyer. That is a natural buyer of stock where they're buying it regardless of valuation because it's a passive investment where people are just purchasing it to get exposure, which again, just drives up the overall market with just additional Wall Street firms getting involved, which you could say, well, it's just in the U.S. No, it's the world stock market. So the world stock market cap is at all-time highs. It's pulled back a little bit, but again, you can see that we've come from the quote-unquote dash to trash in 2009 has sent us on a parabolic move where, if you bought the dip, you crushed it. There has never been a time where you have even really remotely been challenged. Obviously, March of 2020 was the challenge, but we took that back and then some. So the question is, what is going to happen going forward? A new report just came out that claims that nearly 12 million renters will owe about $5,800 in back rent and utilities by early January. So just to put it into context, as we talk about jobs, and we're going to talk about jobs in the next segment, this is something to consider as emerging markets, as we talk about in high frequency data, we're still 20% off of where we were pre-COVID, but yet the market is pricing in euphoria. And it's just, I'm not saying to short the market. I'm just saying that if you are long and if you have captured a lot of this move, nobody has ever gone bankrupt taking profits. That's the knowledge I will leave you today with looking at this chart. But now as we go into, who's buying what? And again, as we talked about with the people that are going to have exposure, and as we talk about that price, again, coming back to the velocity of money, it's the rich that are buying a lot of homes. So applicants for the priciest segment, you know, a couple of weeks ago, we did one about mortgage backdrops, who's getting their mortgage, what level of the credit ratings. And here you can see that 766,000 and above is almost 50% of the mortgages being issued. So if you look at just the 50% and then 150 to 300,000, you're talking about 10%. So again, as we showed before, it's 760 plus. Those are the people that are getting mortgages. Those are the people that are looking to increase their homes. Again, these are the ones that have the ability to and afford to move from urban to suburban. So the prices that are going up on the mortgage side, prices have risen on the home side, but again, they're also being kept low by the 30-year mortgage, by the 30-year rates, because even though you're buying more house, you're paying more for it, but at a lower rate. So then your monthly number is still low, or at least comparable to the rent you were paying. So you're not seeing a big increase in rents. You're seeing a decrease in rents in urban areas. And really, you're seeing a small increase in payment, monthly payments, but nothing meaningful. Again, showing that issue of that calculation of velocity of money. And then when we look at food inflation, again, global prices on a global level, people are getting crushed with food prices. And we've seen it. It's starting to normalize in China, where China actually had a negative CPI. But again, Europe up 3%, US up 2.5%. You know, you're seeing on a global level, and this is going to impact emerging markets way more than advanced economies, because people, and we've done shows on food inflation, showing that we're at a point now where 80 to 85 cents of every dollar in emerging markets is going to food, up from 60 cents. Again, this is just taking money away from buying stuff in advancing economies, because food costs are just becoming so egregious. But, and what is that causing in the market? What's the reflection of that in the market? And here you see TIPS, and the demand for inflation protected securities continues to go higher as people want to protect against potential inflation risks. How is the Fed trying to adjust this? They're actually buying TIPS to try to offset, because they're also concerned about the costs of maintaining that going forward. But this is an area that you're starting to see that people are actually starting to take notice about potential inflation issues as we go forward, which this is just another way to look at the 10-year inflation swap. The inflation, you know, trajectory continues to go up as we see COVID as being deflationary, but now we've gotten a very aggressive reflation or inflation with now $17 trillion worth of debt trading negative, where Portugal at 0% interest rates, first time ever, which, yay, first time ever. So the U.S. inflation expected rise as investors, it's expected in the recovery. The recovery is being priced in. If we get a recovery in prices, GDP increases. And again, the numerator gets stronger because prices are going up. GDP goes up. Denominators, you know, should stay flat, but we've seen it not stay flat. And as we talked about in segment one, with the Fed issuing $160 billion in purchases, the denominator is only going to continue to grow. So then when we look at this in terms of, you know, what do we expect going forward, we have to look at, okay, well, what is the economic data telling us? You know, the inflation is starting to tick higher. People are starting to look for protection. Well, now let's look at some of the underlying economic data points and what does this indicate to us as we head into 2021.